You recently left your longtime political home, the Labour Party. Can you briefly explain why you decided to do so?
And I got to the Labour Party because that's the party that ideologically I felt should be my home. A party that is fighting for peace, for a two-state solution, for social equality, for a separation of religion and state. But sadly, Israeli politics, or especially left-wing politics in Israel, changed dramatically 25 years ago when Prime Minister Rabin, who was the leader of Labour, was assassinated by a Jewish murderer who decided to kill him to stop the peace process. And Labour Party and the entire left-wing politics got frozen. And slowly, the leaders of the left stopped fighting for many of the most ideological, the most important ideological beliefs that we have. The most important one would be fighting for peace. They were afraid of the politics, of the populist politics that came from the right, led by Netanyahu. We're afraid of the incitement and stop talking about the main issues. And what happened, I fought to get these issues back to the main stage of politics. But what happened just now, 2 months ago, was to me the worst decision that the Labour leadership could make. And when Amir Peretz, the leader of Labour, decided that after we got a second chance for these elections, to not do the most responsible and obvious thing, which is to unite the left, to unite the democratic camp of Israel into one party, into one front to save democracy. When he decided to not do that, I realized what his intentions were, and still are. He wants to get into Netanyahu's government. So I decided we have to take a risk, and I went and did everything that I could to unite the democratic union that I'm so proud to be one of the leaders of. So I want to see the Democratic Union, Arab citizens of Israel. I want to see ultra-Orthodox citizens of Israel, men and women participating. I want to see it as a party that is representing every Israeli who believes in democracy, in peace, in social equality, and a freedom of religion for all streams of Judaism and the separation of religion and state in Israel. So the Zionist values that Israel was founded upon, that's the Democratic Union.
Following September's elections, what would be the ideal situation for the Democratic Union in terms of the formation of a government?
Something interesting I learned about democracy in the last few years. Apparently, democracy doesn't make a very loud sound when it's collapsing. It's a very slow process. It starts with the weakening of the parliament, the weakening of the media, of the Supreme Court. It is led by a lot of incitement coming from the populist right. At the beginning, they incited against on certain issues against people on the left, but then the incitement went and crossed every barrier. The only secure solution for Israel, for the Zionist dream, for the continuation of this country as a majority Jewish and democratic, the only solution is a clear border between us and the Palestinians. The future is supposed to be secure, and in such a strong country, we have the means to do this and to promise it, but we have to go back to becoming, to initiate solution and follow our own security interests and not follow a strategy of fear that is keeping us stuck in the place and slowly deteriorating the situation.
I'd like to get back to the application of the intricacies of democracy. So recently, obviously, Israel made the decision to bar two U.S. lawmakers from entering the country due to their support for the boycott, divestment, sanctions movement. Firstly, did you agree with that move? And secondly, what would you do to reinforce U.S. bipartisan congressional support for Israel?
I have a lot of discussions with friends in the U.S. about the BDS. And when I go to universities in the U.S. and I speak against the BDS, one of the first thing that I see is that sometimes those who follow the BDS first do not understand or know that at the core of the BDS there are anti-Semitic organizations, but second of all, they do it because they feel that somehow it might support, it's supposed to support a two-state solution. I think that the opposite is the truth. BDS is one of the most anti-progressive movements. There is nothing progressive about BDS. It's not promoting a two-state solution, it's only seeing one side of the conflict, and much of it doesn't even recognize Israel's right to exist. And now I'll go to what's happening with the state. It is a very stupid thing, diplomatically, to tell any congressman or women or politician from the US, you can't enter because of your opinions. And it's stupid for many reasons. One of them is just diplomatically. If people want to come and we disagree with them, it's the best thing for us that they will come and see Israel and learn the Israeli story, and who knows, maybe we'll change their mind. So that's part of the work of diplomacy. Israel must remain a bipartisan issue in the US. It should never change. And sadly, the involvement that Bibi has taken in the last few years with American politics is hurting us. And more than anything, it doesn't think about the long term. Because governments change. I know that for some Israelis that this is news, but governments change. Definitely in the US, they still have term limit. But we can't risk the future of Israel and our strategic interests by making Israel a partisan issue in the US. We have to constantly keep the connections with all sides of politics, with all communities, with every president, no matter what happens. For Israel's security interests and long term, and also for the connection that we have on our most basic values with the US, we have to keep it this way. So I'm calling from here, every American politician is invited here. I'll be happy to meet with them and show them Israel and to try to argue with them if we disagree with them. And I'm sure that every logical person who will see the complex story of this place and see the forces who are fighting to change what's happening here, I truly believe that people can change their minds as well.